let's take a moment to briefly consider where we are in Scripture. We are in the book of Psalms. It's the hymn book of the Israelites, of the early church, and believers throughout the centuries. Now, many of the Psalms were written by David, king of Israel, or they list another author. But our psalm this morning is written by an anonymous psalmist. This unknown psalmist crafted a beautiful celebration of God's law, his Torah, his covenant instruction to his people. And it's fascinating to realize that what the psalmist is talking about here, he doesn't have in view the whole Bible that we hold in our hands. When he talks about the law, the statutes, the commandments, the testimonies, he's thinking about the first five books of the Bible, the law, the Torah, Genesis, Exodus, and yes, even Leviticus, Numbers, and Deuteronomy. This love for God that he describes here is not coming out of the gospel accounts or the thrilling stories from the Old Testament or even the practical wisdom from the book of Proverbs. No, it's coming from the detailed, specific law of our Lord. Now we can, and I will, apply the psalmist's words to all of Scripture, but we must not neglect the Old Testament, even the law, in favor of some of our favorite passages from the New Testament. All of Scripture is to be valued, studied, and praised. In the words of 2 Timothy 3:16-17, all Scripture, and in Paul's mind, he's thinking of the Old Testament, all Scripture is breathed out by God and is profitable for teaching, for reproof, for correction, and for training in righteousness, that the man of God may be complete, equipped for every good work. As for our psalm this morning, throughout this entire Psalm 119, the author will use at least 8 different Hebrew words to describe the word of God and to praise the Lord for it. All except 4 of the 176 verses in this chapter are directed toward God, psalmist expressing devotion to God and to his word. And this psalm is also an acrostic that follows a set pattern of 22 stanzas or paragraphs of 8 verses each. So what happens is in each 8 verses, every verse starts with the same letter of the Hebrew alphabet. The 2 that we're going to look at today are Bet and Gimel, 9 through 16 and 17 through 24. It'd be kind of like if verses 9 through 16 all started with the letter B, and then verses 17 through 24 all started with the letter C. It's not exactly the same as that in Hebrew, but that's kind of what's going on here. We're going to move past the A section, the Aleph section. It explains the wisdom of obeying God's law and the psalmist's desire to obey God. And then we come to our text. So now that we understand where we are, the context, let's look at the first 8 verses of our text, the Bet section, and we'll see what loving God's word looks like. I'm going to read verses 9 through 16 again. How can a young man keep his way pure? By guarding it according to your word. With my whole heart I seek you. Let me not wander from your commandments. I have stored up your word in my heart, that I might not sin against you. Blessed are you, O Lord. Teach me your statutes. With my lips I declare all the rules of your mouth. In the way of your testimonies I delight, as much as in all riches. I will meditate on your precepts and fix my eyes on your ways. I will delight in your statutes. I will not forget your word. The first thing we should notice is the psalmist's drive to know God and to know his word. He desires to be pure and uncorrupted before God. But he realizes the only way this will happen is if he guards, if he keeps it according to God's word. And as he notes, those who are young in particular need to hear this message. Because far too often we assume that we know better. We think we're more intelligent, more informed than any old authority, whether that's our parents or teachers, bosses, or even God and his word. So in a manner similar to the book of Proverbs, this psalmist is pointing out how foolish that mindset is. A pure life, a right life, a good life is not found in rejecting God's commandments, but in living in them. It is a life completely surrendered to the word of our Lord. This is not a call, though, for perfectionism. This is not that we can live out everything that's said in God's law. Our sinful, rebellious nature prevents us from fully honoring God with our lives. But those who God has saved from sin are enabled to live according to his law. And God's grace is the best assurance, the best guarantee we can have to live a life of purity. While we live, no time is too late to come to God, but particularly for those who are young, now is the time to discipline ourselves to pursue God through the study of his word. Every person has a responsibility to do so, but especially those of us who claim to know the Lord, because we're able to live out the words of verse 10. With my whole heart I seek you. Let me not wander from your commandments. Those of us who have been set free from sin are able to seek God. We can take the same encouragement that a prophet named Azariah gave to a king named Asa in 2 Chronicles 15, 1 and 2. It says, the Spirit of God came upon Azariah, the son of Oded, and he went out to meet King Asa, and he said to them, hear me, Asa, and all Judah and Benjamin, the Lord is with you while you are with him. If you seek him, he will be found by you. But if you forsake him, he will forsake you. Like the psalmist, we can ask God, ask our teacher, to discipline and disciple us, correct and teach us how to study the Bible. If we know the Lord, we can seek him in his word, and we will know that we will find him. His grace enables us to steadfastly, persistently pursue after him. We do this as we come to know God better through the study of his word, because the Bible is how God reveals himself to us. If we read the Bible and we expect to see more of God and more of his character, then we will find it. This is a mindset, though. We have to recognize that God, that Jesus is found on every page and every verse of Scripture. And if we do this, it makes reading the Bible come alive. This means we need to read the Bible less as a self-help book, asking, well, what can God do for me? What does this say about that? And we need to read it more as a where is God book. Where is God in this verse, in this passage, in this story? When we view God and his word in this way, our understanding, our respect, and our worship grows. He alone saves us, and he alone keeps us from falling away. When that happens, then, we desire to please him above all else, as the psalmist does in verse 11. He says, I have stored up your word in my heart. Why? That I might not sin against you. And this verse also calls for a careful memorization, an active pondering on God's word. Because knowing God and knowing his word is the antidote for sin and rebellion against God. Only God can keep us from wandering. And it's only as we know him more through his word that we are kept from sin. The Protestant reformer John Calvin wrote this. He said, if we do not imbibe, absorb the doctrine of God, if we are not well acquainted with it, then Satan will easily surprise and entangle us in his meshes. Our true safeguard, then, lies not in a slender knowledge of the law or in a careless perusal of it, but in hiding it deeply in our hearts. Only God can prevent our straying. He alone is our teacher. As the psalmist prays to God to keep him from wandering, so should we. He does this as he places the best thing in the best place. He places his word in our hearts so we can fulfill his wonderful purpose, his great commission to make disciples of all nations. And this then leads into the model prayer of verse 12. Blessed are you, O Lord. Teach me your statutes. The psalmist praises God, gives him glory, and then asks for grace to know him even more. We are to praise him the same way. Praise him for what he has done and how he has revealed himself to us in his word. And then ask God to give us even more of himself. Because if God does not reveal the truth of his word to us, then we will not grasp it. But once we understand God's word, verse 13 tells us we have a responsibility to declare it to others. With my lips, I declare all the rules of your mouth. This models instructions that God gave to all Israelite parents in Deuteronomy 6:6-7. God says, "And these words I command you today shall be on your heart. You shall teach them diligently to your children, shall talk of them when you sit in your house, when you walk by the way, when you lie down, and when you rise," at all times declaring God's truth. Our love for God and for his word should lead us to declare, to share this good news, this gospel with others. Why? Because according to verse 14, it's worth more than anything that money could buy us. "In the way of your testimonies I delight, as much as in all riches." Those who do not know God value those things, money, possessions, wealth. But in reality, knowing God and his word is worth more than anything money could buy. If our priorities are in order, they will bring us delight. The psalmist knows that wealth is temporary, but that the knowledge of God is priceless and eternal. As we delight, as we take joy in God's word, we are led to meditate on it. Verse 15 says, "I will meditate on your precepts and fix my eyes on your way." Now, meditation here is not the Eastern religious concept of folding your legs and your hands and going, that's not what's going on here. It's an active exercise. It's dwelling on the implications, thinking about God's word. And this shows up several times in this psalm. In our passage, it pops up again in verse 23. "Even though princes sit plotting against me, your servant will meditate on your statutes." Even in the midst of persecution and mocking, the psalmist continues to meditate, study God's word. And then in verse 97, he writes, "Oh, how I love your law. It is my meditation all the day." Meditation, filling our minds with the word of the Lord, is the heavenly food that makes us like God. As the old saying goes, you are what you eat. Meditation conforms, molds us into the image of Jesus Christ. As we know his word, we become more like him. Now, for the psalmist, this meditation leads him to delight, to take joy in God's word. It says, "I delight in your statutes. I will not forget your word." His ability to know God better depends on the fact that it brings him joy. So if we approach studying God's word as a privilege that brings us pleasure, we'll be more successful than if we view it as a chore, something we have to do. This delight in God's law is crucial. The psalmist will bring it up again in verse 24, "Your testimonies are my delight." And we'll talk more about that in a moment. But right now, I've gone on talking about what's been said so far in this psalm, and you're probably thinking, "Pastor John, that's great, but what does that have to do with me? How do I live according to God's law? What does it look like for me to seek him, to store up his word in my heart, to learn his statutes, to declare his word, meditate on it, delight in his word?" Well, for starters, it means that our lives and our church must be governed by the Bible, by God as he is revealed in his word. Any decision that we should make should not be informed primarily from our own opinions or feelings, but it should be based on the truth of God's word. This should be true in our personal lives, but it is absolutely necessary in the church. Anything that we desire to do as a church body must be based on the word of God. But for our personal lives, it means that we practice some of the disciplines listed in this passage. We do not live for ourselves, after all. We live for God. If the Bible commands us to do something, we do it. If it commands us that we do not do something, then we don't. No ifs, ands, or buts. God expects those who know him to read and know his word. You cannot know God apart from knowing his word. If you have not committed to consistently read the Bible, then please do so. Find someone who will hold you accountable to reading and spending regular time in God's word. As we read the Bible, remember that loving God and his word means that we look for God himself in the Bible, not simple, cheap answers to our own personal questions. We pray for and seek to know him. So when you read the Bible, first pray that God would show you himself in his word. Then read carefully and intentionally, looking for what the text says about God. Do not look for some little phrase in the text that you can pull out of context and post on Facebook. No, expect to see God in his word. This section also called us to learn to memorize the Bible. We teach about the Bible here on Sunday mornings, Sunday school, Wednesday nights, throughout the week here at East Shore. And these are just some of the resources that are available to help you learn about God's word. As for memorization, I realize that may be difficult for many of us. And I confess that I do not memorize the Bible as often as I should. But like anything else in our lives, it is something that can be accomplished if we only take the time to do it. And honestly, all it takes is 1 or 2 minutes a day to develop the discipline of memorizing Scripture. And this is helpful, because as Calvin said, when we go through life, we have a responsibility to declare, to share, to talk about the truth of God's word with others. If we see God in the Bible, we should be excited to share that truth with others, those whom we meet, this good news, this gospel. Those of us who God is making holy, making more like him, should desire for others to experience this grace as well. Have you shared this news with others? Perhaps it may be helpful to commit to share with someone, maybe just one person a week, share with them something that you either read or learned from God's word as a way to start talking about what God's word says with others. As for meditation, it's similar to memorization and declaring. It means we have to take time to avoid distractions and meditate, fill our minds with the things of God, truths from God's word. And this may call for sacrificing an interest or a passion for the sake of filling our minds with the things of God. I'm personally embarrassed to admit this, but there are many things that I fill my mind with other than God's word. Those who know me well can attest to the fact that I far more easily quote from my favorite movies or favorite TV shows than I do from God's word. I spend more time reading about entertainment and sports than I do contemplating God's truth. But please hear me. There's nothing wrong with reading or thinking about things other than the Bible. But when those things supplant God in our hearts and in our minds, they become idols that must be removed. In verse 16, we see that loving God and his word also involves delighting in him. And we'll talk more about that in just a moment. But in short, it is loving God and his word above all competitors. So now that we know what loving God, what loving his word looks like, we have to ask, where does this love come from? And we see it's a desire. I'm going to read verses 17 through 24 one more time. Verse 17, deal bountifully with your servant, that I may live and keep your word. Open my eyes, that I may behold wondrous things out of your law. I am a sojourner on the earth. Hide not your commandments from me. My soul is consumed with longing for your rules at all times. You rebuke the insolent, accursed ones who wander from your commandments. But take away from me scorn and contempt, for I have kept your testimonies. Even though princes sit plotting against me, your servant will meditate on your statutes. Your testimonies are my delight. They are my counselors. In these verses, we see love for God, love for his word, intensified as a desire. This started back in verse 16. I delight in your statutes. And it's picked up again in verses 47, 92, and 174. It's defined as love in verse 47. For I find my delight in your commandments. Why? Which I love. Verse 92 exposes our hopelessness if we do not delight in God's commandments. If your law had not been my delight, I would have perished in my affliction, would not have made it through my life. And then the psalmist equates it to salvation. In verse 174, I long for your salvation, O Lord, and your law is my delight. What does this lead to? well, in the words of verse 17, it causes us to gracefully and gratefully live for God. Deal bountifully with your servant, that I may live and keep your word. Our love is revealed in holy obedience. This is what we are to live for. There are many people, myself included, probably you, who have prayed to God asking for a long life. But rarely do we think about what that life is to be lived for. What is its purpose? My friends, a life that is lived not knowing, not obeying God is a wasted life. The psalmist's prayer is that his life may be used to know Scripture better. Why Scripture? Because it reveals wondrous things about God's character and his works. But he knows that in order to see those things, to see God in Scripture, we need our eyes opened, our spiritual eyes, and only God can do that. He says in verse 18, "Open my eyes that I may behold wondrous things out of your law." Now, this is not some supernatural vision he's getting or some mysterious feeling. It's the Holy Spirit's insight beyond our abilities to recognize God in his word. And this is why it both is and is not possible for a non-Christian to understand the Bible. On the one hand, the Bible is a collection of facts that you can learn and memorize. You can know all about the different books and their context and the history behind it. Heck, you could even memorize the entire Bible. But unless the Holy Spirit opens the eyes of our unbelieving hearts, we will never see God as he is revealed in Scripture. This is known as the illumination of Scripture. It's like the Holy Spirit turns on a light so we're able to clearly see God in his word. Because otherwise we would stumble in darkness and confusion. The psalmist knows that this priceless treasure of God himself can only be found in his word. So he prays that God would reveal it to him. The psalmist realized that if anyone understands Scripture, it is solely by the grace of God. He shows us wondrous, marvelous things that awe us, inspire us, humble us, and convince us of our need to know more of God's grace each and every day. When we know, when we love God's word, when we belong to him, that means we become strangers in our own world, foreigners in our own land. Verse 19 says, "I am a sojourner on the earth. Hide not your commandments from me." King David prayed to God in 1 Chronicles 29:15 this prayer, "For we are sojourners before you, and sojourners as all our fathers were. Our days on the earth are like a shadow, and there is no abiding. We are strangers and sojourners on earth. This world is temporary, but God and his word are eternal." Those who do not love God and his word are unable to understand what we feel, what we recognize, what we see in the Bible. Hebrews 11 would use the same language of sojourners and strangers to describe God's people. There's a list of faithful saints in Hebrews 11. And then after that, verse 13 says, "These all died in the faith, not having received the things promised, but having seen them and greeted them from afar, and having acknowledged that they were strangers and exiles on the earth." And why do they do this? Because they desire a better country, that is, a heavenly one. "Therefore, God is not ashamed to be called their God, for he has prepared for them a city." As strangers in this world, we need the guidance of God's word to move through this enemy territory toward our true home. If you'll indulge me, I have another Calvin quote I really enjoy. He says, "The great concern of the unholy and the worldly is to spend their life here easily and quietly. But those who know that they have their journey to pursue and have their inheritance reserved for them in heaven are not engrossed, nor are they entangled with these perishable things, but they aspire after that place to which they are invited." Christian, you are a stranger to the world. You will not be here long. Do not be a stranger to God. What is the desire behind this, these earthly strangers' love for God and His Word? It's a desire for God Himself, a desire for His Word that He has given us. Listen to verse 20. My soul is consumed with longing for your rules at all times. The psalmist says he is consumed, he is paralyzed, he is exhausted with longing for the Word of God. Can we say the same? Because what we prize reveals our hearts. But we can act against our desire for a time, but our desires themselves never lie. The kind of desire that's described here, a heart desire for God and for His Word, is one of the best ways to know who truly belongs to Him. The heart described here is a heart of someone who loves God. In verse 40, the psalmist says, this is because the Lord's words give life. Behold, I long for your precepts. In your righteousness, give me life. According to verse 174, they contain God's salvation. I long for your salvation, O Lord, and in your law is my delight. Another psalm paints it a pretty famous way in a popular hymn. It says, as a deer pants for flowing streams, so pants my soul for you, O God. And then our psalm again in verse 131 uses the same image and says, I open my mouth and pant because I long for your commandments. When God grants life to a lost sinner, the sinner develops a spiritual appetite for the Lord's truth and for the Lord Himself. This is different from those who are introduced in verses 21 through 23, those who reject God's word, oppress His true people, the insolent, accursed ones, the princes who sit plotting. The psalmist trusts God to defend him against these people. He says, take away from me scorn and contempt. I have kept your testimonies. Friends, the world and its arrogance looks down on our obsession with the Word of God. But this pressure should not lead us to waver in our commitment to God. We are to continue in meditation, studying God's Word, our spiritual nourishment, and then truthfully declare what we have been taught. Delight in the revelation of God in the Bible. In verse 23, he commits that your servant will meditate on your statutes. And he expresses this resolution again in verses 161 and 162. He says that princes persecute me without cause, but my heart stands in awe of your words. I rejoice at your word like one who finds great spoil. God's judgment against wickedness may be delayed in our eyes, but we can trust that it will come. And finally, as he did in verse 16, the psalmist declares his delight, his joy, his pleasure in the Word of God. Your testimonies are my delight. They are my counselors. From it, he receives the counsel, the direction he needs to get through the trials of life. Now, we have just read two sections of the 22 stanzas of this psalm, and the whole psalm continues the same theme of love for God and love for His Word. My friends, could you have written this psalm? Is this your heart's desire? And the key to answering that is in verse 20. Verse 20 says again, my soul is consumed with longing for your rules at all times. Do you have that same desire? Do you long to know God and His Word more? Or do you seek to satisfy your own desires? This psalm points to the desires, the attitudes that we are to have. God delights in us when we delight in Him. Commenting on this verse in a sermon, the British pastor Charles Spurgeon wrote this, better to feel a heavenly hunger than a worldly fullness, and heartbreak for God is a sweeter thing than content in sinful pleasures. Do you feel the same? Now, perhaps it may help to illustrate this from a believer's life from the past. And one man whose life demonstrated this love for God and His Word was William Tyndale. He was an English believer, lived from 1497 to 1536. In a time when it was illegal to have or even read a Bible in any language other than Latin, Tyndale was convinced of this, that it's impossible to establish in the lay people in any truth except the scripture were laid before their eyes in their mother tongue. He loved God's word, and he wanted it to be in the hands, in the hearts, in the minds of the English people. He made it his life's mission to translate the Bible from the original Hebrew and Greek into English. Unfortunately, his desires made him a fugitive, forced him to live in exile from England. And in the midst of constant fear of arrest, imprisonment, and death, he continued his translation work and even took the time to encourage others with these words. I'll try to say it in a bit more modern way. Let it not make you despair, neither yet it discourage you, O reader, that it is forbidden you in pain of life and goods, or that it is made breaking of the king's peace, his law, or treason unto his highness, to read the word of your soul's health. For if God be on our side, what matter does it make who is against us, be they bishops, cardinals, popes, or anyone else? Now, eventually, Tyndale was betrayed. He was arrested, he was condemned as a heretic, and he was executed by strangling before his body was burned at the stake. His last words were said to be the ones on the screen behind me. Lord, open the King of England's eyes. Almost quoting verse 18 from our passage. 2 years after Tyndale's death, the King of England would authorize an official English translation of the Bible for the Church of England. Both this translation and a more famous one made about 70 years later, known as the King James Version, are heavily dependent on Tyndale's work. About 80% of the King James Version is a copy of Tyndale's translation of the Bible. My friends, without William Tyndale, we do not read the Bible in English. I hope you see in this that love for God's word is not something that we can manufacture. I do not want you to be discouraged if you do not feel you love God and his word, like this psalmist or like William Tyndale. If you do, though, long to love God more, you know you're not there, but you long to love him more, you long to pursue him more, friends, that's the Holy Spirit convicting you of your need for God. Our sins expose our need for a Savior, not just once for all for sin, though definitely that, but for those of us who know him every day as we overcome sin and become more like him. As you long for and look to God, you focus less on yourself and your own selfish interest. God uses our longing to make us trust, depend on him more. My friends, if you want to love God more, look to him. Just as Jesus did everything to save us, he also does everything to make us love him more. This is the way that God's word points to him. This is the attitude of dependence that leads you to say, my soul is consumed with longing for your rules at all times, and also lead you to say that your testimonies are my delight. What does this mean for us today? It means that we are to love God and trust him by loving and trusting his word. This love does not come from us. It's available through the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ. Our natural tendency, though, is to sin. We reject God, his word, and his grace. But God has paid that debt through the substitute sacrifice of his son. If we repent, if we turn from sin, believe, trust, put all our faith and hope in Christ, then he enables us to understand and then trust his word. We are able to confidently depend on God's promises. And if we have confidence in the word, we can have confidence in Christ. We can be bold in our faith and in our witness, knowing that he is true to his promises. He is in control of all things, and he will never leave us nor forsake us. And loving God and his word also means that we do what it says. Do not fight with the commands of God. If you know Christ, trust him to help you live them. I know it's not always easy to do that, but it's a simple matter to understand. While we live on earth, we will constantly battle between our love for God and his word and between our sinful nature. But there is hope for the future. And the Apostle Paul wrote about this conflict in the book of Romans, chapter 7, verses 23 and 25. Paul writes, "For I delight in the law of God, in my inner being." He sounds like the psalmist here. But he says, I see in my members another law, waging war against the law of my mind, making me captive to the law of sin that dwells in my members. Wretched man that I am, who will deliver me from this body of death?" But look at his glorious conclusion. "Thanks be to God through Jesus Christ our Lord. For those that know him, Jesus will deliver them from their sinful desires, restore their relationship with God. We should long for the day when we will no longer be ashamed or feel we have to hide, but instead are fully, completely free from sin. Our great desire, our great love will be realized. We will be filled with his fullness. We will never get enough of God. He will continue to give us more of himself throughout all eternity. The love for God and for his word never ends." However, if you do not know the Lord, then it is impossible for you to know his word. You cannot know his word. You cannot know him if you do not, you cannot love his word. You cannot know him without faith. May I ask, are you ready for that to change? Are you ready to know Jesus and be truly known by him? These are some more words from Pastor Charles Spurgeon. He says, "There is in God whatever your soul needs. In Christ Jesus, there is exactly what your soul is panting for." In a few moments, we're going to have a time of response. And you can use this time to talk to me if you'd like to know more about what it means to know Jesus Christ. Or I encourage you to talk to me after the service, or talk to someone you know who is a follower of Christ, how you can have a relationship with him. But as we enter this time of response, I also have a challenge for those of you who do know Christ, who are believers. Please use this time to repent, turn from your selfish desires, and depend on Christ. Do you desire, do you long for God? Do you hunger for his word? If not, pray that he will make it so. Then commit to read, to seek, to learn, to memorize, to declare, to meditate on, and to delight in the word of our Lord. My friends, these verses we've read show powerful truths from God's word that demand a response. Come to Christ. Delight in him. Commit to love him and to love his word, because he alone is worthy.